Today, topic of discussion is active and passive insufficiency. Before going to elaborate the active and passive insufficiency, we should be familiarized with terminologies and concepts which can be helpful in understanding the concept of active and passive insufficiency of muscle. First and most important thing we should know is one joint muscle as well as two joint muscle. How one joint, what is it? One joint muscle and what is two joint muscle? It means the muscle which originates, suppose supinator. Supinator originates from below elbow and insert above wrist. It means this muscle is controlling or producing movement only at one joint. But we have some muscle, many muscles which are crossing more than one joint, two joint, three joint, or we can say multi-joint. So these muscles, some are crossing one joint, some are crossing two joint or three joint. This crossing pattern of muscle, this length of muscle can play an important role in active and passive insufficiency of muscle. First, I would like to elaborate some important findings of one joint muscle. The one muscle which crosses only one joint. I have given you example like supinator. A normal one joint muscle possesses sufficient contact latitude shortened through the full range of motion afforded by joint, suppose supinator and pronator. They are one joint muscle. They originate below elbow and insert above wrist. So for production of torque, production of movement by the contraction of this muscle is sufficient to create mobility over only one joint. So if the muscle will contract maximally, it will produce maximal tension at one joint, because that muscle is performing movement only and only over one joint. And as you can see, supinate, the person is going to pronate his arm. Pronate. Apply more force. When you are resisting this type of movement, which is performed by single joint muscle, the maximum torque production of that muscle will be maximum at the end range of motion. Again, I would like to demonstrate you. Perform the movement. See, in this patient, subject is doing pronation of hand, and pronation of hand is performed by the pronator of forearm, and because pronator of forearm is single joint muscle, so it will produce maximal tension when this muscle will contract fully. So all single joint muscle can produce maximum force when it is contracted fully. Same as the example can be given by supinator also. Supinator is also a one joint muscle which causes supination of forearm. Again, go for supination. Yeah. As the individual, as the subject will go from pronation to supination, as we will complete the range, the force production by muscle will be increases. So by completing the range, the amount of force production by muscle will be more. So in case of all single joint muscle, the force production is directly proportional to end range. When the bone is moving by a single joint muscle, it will exert a strong effective force in its most shortened position, which is a complete joint range of motion. Suppose, for example, if I imagine, and it is not, suppose biceps. Biceps is a one joint muscle originating from scapula and inserting over radius. When you are going for here, it is producing maximal force at the end range. So all single joint muscle produce maximal amount of torque at end range of the motion. Second is two joint muscle or multi joint muscle. The muscle which crosses more than one joint is known as two joint or multi joint muscle. A normal two joint muscle does not possess sufficient contractility to shorten at both the joints simultaneously, exert a strong effective force within the mid range of its overall length. Suppose, for example, like your flexor of forearm, they are originating from the medial epicondyle of humerus, and they are going through the wrist, MCP joint, IP joint to all. Clear? It means one flexor muscle of forearm is crossing many joints. From here, one joint, two joint, three joint, four joint. Clear? So one muscle is producing mobility at multi joint. So when you are going to produce contraction over many joint by one muscle, so muscle cannot be effectively or efficiently produce contraction or torque at each and every time joint. Clear? See, suppose this is a flexor of forearm, and the function of flexor of forearm is producing flexion over wrist, flexion over MCP joint, flexion over PIP joint, flexion over DIP joint. When you flex your wrist, you cannot effectively flex your finger because of lack of shortening of the flexor, because this is a muscle originated from here, and the complete length of muscle is this. When you are going to shorten, what is shortening? By shortening, muscle is producing force. Okay, one component. It means muscle is shortened up to some extent. Again, you are going for flexion here. Muscle is shortened again. Again, you are producing flexion here. It means at PIP joint, shortened. When you are going to shorten your DIP joint, you cannot shorten it forcefully because the flexors muscle is already shortened at many joint. So, two joint muscle has to perform function at many joint, so he cannot perform its function effectively at all ranges. That's why two joint muscle exert a strong effective force within the mid range of its overall range. Clear? So there are two types of muscle: single joint muscle, double joint muscle, or multi joint muscle. When you want to produce maximal force by single joint muscle, you should apply force through full range of motion. Clear? And when you are going to produce force by two joint muscle or three joint muscle, you should perform the activity in mid range of motion. This is the main fundamentals of one joint muscle and two joint muscle. So you just analyze which sports activity you needed to perform, you needed to produce force, which muscle is going to produce force. If you are analyzing, this is the muscle which need to produce force and this is single joint muscle, so you should produce maximum contraction, maximum range of motion for that muscle. And if you feel this is the multi joint muscle and we are going to use this muscle for a specific sport, so we should keep that muscle in mid range, so in mid range that muscle can produce maximal force. Clear? So we have two type of muscle: single joint muscle, double joint muscle, and both muscle can play a different role in different sports activities. In some sports where we are going to use single joint muscle, I am pulling something, I am holding something. In some sport you need to hold properly. It means when you are holding something, holding involve flexion of wrist, so flexion over MCP joint, flexion over PIP joint, flexion over DIP joint. So when you flex all joint, you cannot hold that object properly because of active insufficiency. The active element which is producing movement, which is the active element in this movement, your flexor, your agonist muscle. When your agonist muscle is shortened at different joint, it cannot effectively produce contraction. So it is clear when we are going to use single joint muscle, we should apply force at the end range of motion. And when you are going to use multi joint muscle, we should try to generate or apply force in mid range of motion. So by these two concepts, the concept of active and passive insufficiency generated. The term passive insufficiency refers to lack of muscle length, whereas the term active insufficiency refers to lack of muscle strength. Okay. One, active insufficiency and passive insufficiency. In active insufficiency, there is lack of muscle strength. In passive insufficiency, there is lack of muscle strength. How can we understand these two things? In one, muscle length is shortened. In other, in passive insufficiency, muscle length is shortened. In active insufficiency, muscle strength is shortened. Clear? Before going to this explanation, I would like to explain two things. One is, we can perform movement by muscle, and muscle can act as an antagonist, they can act as an agonist, and they can also act as a synergist. Muscle can play different role in different movement. Muscle, the ultimate purpose of muscle is shortening, and by shortening and relaxing, muscle is producing tension, and because of tension and relaxation, muscle is. So there, muscle can play its role in different manner. Muscle can act as an agonist, it can act as an antagonist, as well as it can act as a synergist. What is agonist? Suppose if you are doing some movement, so the muscle which is primarily doing, actively mean directly doing, the muscle which is directly producing that movement is active element. Clear? Suppose when you are going for wrist flexion, so wrist flexor will be agonist. Wrist flexor will be agonist because you are producing flexion as wrist. So this flexion movement is because of shortening of forearm flexor. Clear? But there are some other structure which have some role in this movement. They are mainly antagonist. They are mainly wrist extensor. When your wrist flexors are shortened, your extensors are lengthened. And for a smooth and coordinated movement, both should work properly. Both should play their role. And agonist should shorten as well as antagonist should lengthen. And this is the concept of active and passive insufficiency. If your agonist is not able to shorten, if your agonist is not able to shorten properly because of any reason, we will say the person is having active insufficiency. If the person is not able to perform complete movement by weakness, by not proper force production by active muscle, agonist muscle, we will say patient is having active insufficiency. But if the movement is limited by shortening of extensor, because suppose when you are going to make fist in this position, clear? See, I am going to make fist. I cannot make proper fist because of multi-joint shortening. See, my wrist, at wrist flexor is shortened, at MCP joint flexor is shortened, at IP joint flexor is shortened, at DIP. So I cannot make fist properly. This is the example of active insufficiency. Clear? But if I am going like this, see, this. Flexion of wrist causes extension of finger. Clear? When you extension of finger mean, when you are flexing the flexor at wrist, it will cause extension of finger over MCP, PIP and DIP. This is known as passive insufficiency, because of when you are going to shorten agonist, it will cause lengthening of antagonist, and because of lengthening of antagonist, the fingers will be straightened at MCP, PIP and DIP joint. So this is mainly agonist and antagonist are responsible for active and passive insufficiency. In active insufficiency, agonist is not able to contract fully, or agonist is not able to produce maximal torque because of that muscle is crossing many joints. Same as what happened in passive insufficiency, muscle is not able to shorten because muscle is not able to shorten because of lengthening of the antagonist muscle. So it active and passive insufficiency is defined by different structure as defined by O'Connell and Gardiner. If a muscle which crosses two or more joint, produces simultaneous movement at all joint of that it crosses. Clear? As I have shown you, a muscle which crosses two or more joint, like flexor of forearm, it crosses one joint, two joint, three joint, four joint. So a muscle, according to O'Connell and Gardner, he is saying a muscle which crosses two or more joint, it will produce simultaneous movement, together movement at all joint. When you are contracting flexor, it will cause contraction of all joint from where it passes or crosses. It soon reaches a length at which it can no longer generate useful amount of force. Clear? Because when you are going to shorten muscle here, 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 when you shorten muscle at different level, the muscle will not able to generate maximal tension, because we have length tension relationship of muscle. Whenever the sarcomere length will be shorter than resting length, it will not be able to produce maximum tension. Same as when muscle length is longer than its resting length, it will not be able to produce maximum tension. Same as here, if a muscle is crossing many joints and you are producing movement at one joint, two joint, so it cannot produce maximum force at all joint because amount of force generation will be diminished because of shortened structure of that agonist muscle. Under this condition, the muscle is called to be actively insufficient. It means the active antagonist is not able to produce maximum torque at all joint. Clear? I would like to demonstrate you again. Please come here. Suppose, according to O'Connell, is saying if a muscle is crossing many joints and when you are going to produce movement, suppose this is a forearm flexor, the forearm flexor function is production of flexion over wrist, flexion over MCP, this is MCP joint, same as flexion over PIP joint, flexion over DIP joint. Now I am going to produce contraction of this active muscle, agonist means active, agonist, the muscle which is actively participating in production of movement. See here, he is flexing wrist here, again, and he is flexing wrist by his active mean his own effort, his own will. Again, he is going to flex his finger at MCP joint. You can see it is a MCP joint, metacarpophalangeal joint. Again, he is going to make flexion over proximal interphalangeal, PIP joint, proximal interphalangeal joint. And when he will try to make here, he cannot make fist so stronger. Clear? Because the muscle is shortened here, then again short active is here, again here, here. So muscle is shortening at different level, so the length of sarcomere is decreased. So, and we all know by length tension relationship, when sarcomere length is decreased, muscle cannot generate maximal amount of torque. And this phenomenon is known as active insufficiency. This active insufficiency is also explained by Kendall et al. Also, he said the inability of two joint or multi joint muscle to generate an effective force when placed in fully shortened position. The same meaning, clear? Fully shortened position. He will not be able to make fist properly. You can demonstrate all these things over on your hand also. See, the person is not able, with wrist flex, he is not able to make fist properly. But If you can see other thing, when he is flexing his wrist, he is having this type of finger. When he is going to flexion, it will cause extension of wrist. The other thing I am going to explain, example. The other example of active insufficiency in body, I can demonstrate to you, when one tries to achieve full hip extension with maximum knee flexion. When the person is trying to achieve full hip extension with maximum knee flexion, I will demonstrate on him. I'm going to ask the patient to go for maximum hip extension. Go for maximum hip extension. Hip extension. Back. No. Hip extension. No. Only extend the hip. Clear. I will demonstrate to you. Suppose, if I am going for maximal hip extension, this is my maximum hip extension. Clear? See the range. I can touch the ground here. It means I have more range. And hip extension is produced by your glute. Clear? I am going for this type of movement over hip joint. I am doing hip extension. But if I flex my knee, then I will go for hip extension. I cannot achieve more range. I will demonstrate you the same thing over the other subject. If he is going for hip extension with in knee extension, hip extension in straight knee position. Again, you go for hip extension in knee flex position. Flex the knee, 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 and go for hip extension. Go for hip extension. No, he cannot achieve more length. If he try, he will extend the thing also. Clear? The other example of active insufficiency, when you extend your hip in straight knee position, you can achieve more range. But when you will try to extend your hip in knee flex position, you cannot achieve more range. It is because hamstring are incapable. Hamstring is a muscle which is responsible for extension of hip and flexion of knee. Clear? One muscle is performing two function. One muscle, that is hamstring, is performing two function. Function number one, it is producing extension of hip. Clear? And second thing, it is producing flexion of knee. When you are taking two work by one muscle, it is working at two places. So anyone, any person, if he is working at two places, he cannot work effectively. It is normal, generalized example. When you appoint one person to work at two places, his work may be affected. He cannot efficiently work. But if you assign a work of a person at one place, he can effectively. Same as here, when a muscle which is working at two joints and you are trying to perform, to produce movement of same muscle at both joints simultaneously, at same time, it cannot perform its best at both joints. This is known as active insufficiency, because active means the muscle is directly producing movement at hip joint also, at knee joint. When you are going for hip extension and knee flexion, both are the function of hamstring. Hip extension and knee flexion, both are the function of hamstring. So when you are doing both movement at one time, you cannot go for maximum force production by hamstring. But when you are going like this, or when you are making your hip neutral and then push, you can push effectively. You can apply more force by hamstring. But if you go like this and then apply more force, you cannot. You can see here, if you are going to apply force by hamstring in neutral hip position, it means you are producing movement only and only at one joint. See, you can apply more force by, you can apply, you can produce more torque by hamstring. Clear? Because you are producing movement, you are producing force by that muscle only at one joint. But if you try to produce force at both joints by a single muscle which is crossing two joints by at one time, you cannot. Suppose if you go for extension, then you apply force, you cannot apply more force by hamstring. This is the phenomenon of, this is the concept of active insufficiency. In a short, we can say, because of shortened length of muscle, because of shortened length of agonist, because agonist is producing movement at different joint at the same time, so it cannot effectively, efficiently produce maximum force because of being its two joint muscle. Clear? So all two joint muscle which are producing movement at different joint at one time, it cannot effectively produce contraction. It cannot effectively produce maximum force. That's why we will say the muscle is insufficient to produce maximum torque. It is known as active insufficiency of muscle. Second is passive insufficiency. What is passive insufficiency? As defined by Connell and Gardner, passive insufficiency of muscle is indicated where a full range of motion of any joint that the muscle crosses is limited by that muscle length rather than by arrangement of ligament or structure. Clear? I have told you agonist is a muscle which produces movement and antagonist is the muscle which controls the movement of agonist. Clear? I will demonstrate you. Suppose now I am going to explain something about how we can understand passive insufficiency. Before explaining the concept of passive insufficiency, first I would like to explain how bone movement is controlled. This is a, suppose, for example, if this is a bone and this bone is controlled by two group of muscle. One muscle which is producing movement is agonist and other muscle which is opposing movement is antagonist. So in resting stage, the bone is controlled by both agonist and antagonist. But when your agonist is going to shorten, it will shorten and causing lengthening of the antagonist. But when antagonist will achieve its maximum extensibility. Maximum extensibility means the maximum elastic limit of the antagonist. It will not allow further the mobility of bone. So whatever force is applied by your active element is waste. It cannot produce bone to move. Clear? This is known as passive insufficiency. I can demonstrate the same thing in the joint. See, this is a wrist joint. When you put your wrist in flexion, there is a flexion of your wrist. When you are going, suppose in this position, you have like this movement. When you are going to produce flexion over wrist, it is causing extension of fingers. See again, flexion of wrist causes extension of finger. For flexion, it will cause automatic extension. You don't want to produce extension. You are not going to produce extension over finger. You are not going to produce extension over finger. But when you are producing movement by agonist, it means you want to produce only and only flexion of wrist. But it causes extension of finger. It is because of lengthening of the antagonist. This is the concept of passive insufficiency. So passive insufficiency, as defined by Kandal, shortness of two joint muscle, the length of muscle is not sufficient to permit normal elongation over both joints. So when you are going to produce movement by agonist in shortened position, because of lengthening of antagonist, it will not allow the joint to move in full range of motion. So active insufficiency is because of inability of active element agonist to produce maximum torque at complete range of motion because it is crossing many joints. Same as passive insufficiency is because of lengthening, shortened length of antagonist muscle. Thank you. Topic of presentation is reciprocal innervation and inhibition. Reciprocal innervation and inhibition. This is the neurophysiological response of muscle to stretch. Okay, how your muscle is responding, how your nerve and muscle is working in coordination, from where the signals are coming in, how after getting signal by nerve, the muscle is going to respond, we will study in reciprocal inhibition and innervation. What is reciprocal inhibition as well as innervation? The excitation of one group of muscle is often associated with inhibition of other group of muscle. Excitation means when you are going to contract one muscle, one group of muscle, the other group will not contract at that time. Clear? How it is possible? Suppose when you are going to flex your elbow, when you are going to make your fist, why your fingers are not extending? Some important structure, some important factor which are facilitating that movement. So if any in any condition when one group of muscle will excite the other group of muscle of the same area will be inhibited. What is excitement, exciting and what is inhibition? Exciting mean muscle is producing action muscle, there is an action potential in muscle, muscle is going to shorten and muscle is producing tension because of shortening. At the same time, the other group, the same antagonist of that same joint is not shortening because of reciprocal inhibition. For example, when a stretch reflex, I have given you an example, whenever you are going to stretch any muscle, and because of stretching of any muscle, it often inhibits the antagonist muscle. When you stretch any muscle, suppose you are going to stretch your flexor. Because muscle has a property of contractility as well as extensibility. Clear? When you stretch anything, it will recoil. It is natural phenomenon. Whenever you will apply any stretch over muscle, it will go in contraction. When you remove the stretch, it will be contracted. So whenever after getting stretched, when muscle is going to contract, it antagonist will relax, because if it will not relax, it you cannot produce contraction in that muscle. This is a phenomenon of reciprocal inhibition. It means contraction of antagonist causes relaxation of agonist, same as vice versa. Contraction or shortening of agonist causes relaxation of antagonist. And how this phenomenon occur? How this is possible? When you are going to contract one group, other group is relaxing. It means there are some forces, there are some mechanism which is operating this system. Clear? Because we are being a normal individual, we are able to perform a smooth and coordinated movement. And a smooth and coordinated movement is not possible without getting support from all group of muscle, ligament, joint, tendon, each and every structure which form the joint, which form the leverage system of joint. Clear? So when you are going to flex one group of muscle, the other group will relax. And this is because of reciprocal inhibition and innervation. So what is the reciprocal inhibition? This contraction of one group and relaxation of other group is known as reciprocal inhibition mechanism. And the neuronal circuit, the mechanism, the whole neuronal system which is responsible for this type of arrangement is known as reciprocal inhibition. Okay, so what is the mechanism? How this happen? When you are going to shorten one, other is relaxing. It means there is some system, there is some mechanism which is controlling. Suddenly your brain is not aware. If you are going to flex, other is going to extend. When you are going to flex, other is going to extend. It means how can we explain this mechanism? The group one afferent fiber means sensory fibers which are giving information to the spinal cord and from spinal cord to central nervous system. So whenever your group one afferent after entering a spinal cord gives a collateral branch that synapse on the interneuron. As you can see in the diagram, it is clear that whenever your group one afferent is coming to the spinal cord, it is making synapse with the group of other afferent. The group of one efferent fiber after entering the spinal cord gives off a collateral branch that synapses on an interneuron. This interneuron in turn synapses on the antagonist alpha motor neuron, which is inhibitory. It causes an action potential in the alpha motor neuron that is ultimately manifested as a reflexion of relaxation of muscle. So reciprocal inhibition means when you are going to contract one group of muscle, the other group will relax. How, what is the mechanism of it? Whenever a muscle, one muscle group is contracting, shortening, it will stimulate group afferent of that fiber, that group afferent fiber will send impulses to spinal cord, and in spinal cord, it will make a synapse in inhibitory interneurons with the other group of muscle. Clear? So, when you are going to stimulate one group, it will inhibit the activity of other group. This can be better understood by understanding the reflex mechanism as given in diagram. Whenever any sensory efferent is going within the muscle, it is making polysynaptic connection within the spinal cord. Clear? So what is polysynaptic connection? It means there are number of synapses from ipsilateral muscle as well as contralateral muscle. Same as in the same limb, it can make synaptic connection with agonist as well as antagonist. When you will excite the interneurons of agonist muscle, at the same time, it will apply, if it will exert a inhibitory effect over the motor neurons of the antagonist side. So, because of inhibition of motor neuron of antagonist side, it can inhibit the activity of that muscle fiber. So, what happens when you are going to contract one group of muscle, the other group of muscle will be relaxed because of this type of neuronic arrangement. Even in spinal cord, if you are going to produce movement at one muscle, that muscle is making excitatory synapse in spinal cord, and the other group, other muscle, other antagonist muscle, the same impulses are making inhibitory connection with that group of spinal cord. And the third one is autogenic inhibition. What is autogenic inhibition? The GTO, as it monitors tension in the muscle fiber being stressed, has an inhibitory effect on level of muscle tension in the muscle tendon unit in which it lies, particularly if stress forces is prolonged. This effect is called autogenic inhibition. So we can understand these three phenomena. By first is reflex inner reciprocal innervation. What is reciprocal innervation? Reciprocal innervation mean there are group 1 efferent fiber, sensory fiber, motor fiber. Whenever one fiber will be stimulated, it will make a synaptic connection with the other group of muscle fiber of the same joint. Clear? For example, when you are exciting antagonist muscle, the group 1 efferent is going to make synapse in spinal cord with the antagonist muscle of the same limb. And when one group interneuron is excited, the other group will be inhibited. This mechanism is known as reciprocal inhibition. Same as vice versa, when your antagonist muscle will be stimulated, your agonist will be relaxed. The next important topic I am going to discuss is neurophysiological response of muscle to stretch. Okay, whenever muscle is stretched either actively or passively, how it responds? We will study the response of muscle to stretch under these three headings. First is reciprocal inhibition, second is reciprocal innervation, and third is autogenic inhibition. What is reciprocal inhibition? Reciprocal inhibition means opposite. Every movement, every joint is supplied by two group of muscle, and any movement is possible because muscle, different muscle are working differently. Some muscle is working as agonist mainly. What is agonist? They are mainly producing movement. Some muscles are working as antagonist. What is antagonist? They are controlling movement from backside. And apart from agonist and antagonist, there are two other group of muscle which are taking part, which are playing important role in the movement production of a particular joint. They are mainly stabilizers as well as fixator. Stabilizer and fixator are same thing. And what is synergist? Synergist are working along with the agonist to facilitate the movement. So the movement is because of all four function of muscle, and all muscle, all other muscle, they are performing their all four functions: synergist, antagonist, agonist, and stabilizers in coordination. How this coordination is possible? It means there are some physiology, some factors, some forces which are controlling, which are directing these muscles to perform their role in a specific movement. Suppose if you are going to flex your elbow, during flexion of your elbow, some muscle is directly producing flexors, some are controlling from backside, they are antagonist. And when you are producing flexion, one muscle is shortened, that is agonist. Agonist is shortened, whereas antagonist is going to be lengthened. How it is possible? During one movement, one muscle is shortened and other muscle is lengthened. This mechanism is controlled by some higher level at the neural level, and these are nerves which are controlling the movement pattern of the muscle. Some muscle is going to be shortened, that is known as contraction, and some muscle is going to be lengthened, because without contraction of one group as well as recession of other group, the bone cannot perform movement. Same as I have demonstrated you, suppose if I want to control this movement by two group of muscle, one is from this side, one from this side, and this is attached. If you are pulling the fists toward this side, pulling your finger toward this side, it means it should be relaxed. If this is one group is contacted, other group should relax for a smooth and coordinated movement. How this is possible? This is because of phenomenon of reciprocal inhibition. It means one group of muscle during any movement, if one group of muscle is contracting, the other group of muscle that is placed opposite to that muscle, it means, suppose you are taking example agonist, so antagonist. If agonist is contracting, antagonist should relax, because without relaxation of antagonist, agonist contraction in effective manner is not possible. You cannot say that movement normal. So what happened? The exercise, how it is possible? When one group is quiet, the other group inhibit. How it is possible? It is because of reciprocal inhibition. What is it? Is because of reciprocal innervation. Now let us understand what is reciprocal innervation. We all know our muscle is able to function only and only because of nerve. All muscles are supplied by sensory as well as motor nerve. What is sensory nerve? The function of sensory nerve is sending information to the higher center, that is central nervous system, regarding the responses which are happening in the muscle belly is conveyed to the higher center, that is spinal cord and brain, via sensory nerve. And by getting information from those sensory nerve, the spinal cord sends its response to that muscle with the help of motor nerve. Clear? So whenever we will apply, now let us discuss phenomenon of reciprocal inhibition and innervation. Suppose when you are going to produce some movement, some stretch, suppose if I am stretching one of my muscle, and as you know, in stretch reflex, what is stretch reflex? When you stretch a one group of muscle, when you remove the stretch, it will relax. It is because of the property of muscle, because muscle is having property of extensibility as well as elasticity. Whenever you will apply stretch over muscle, when you remove the stretch force, it will relax or it will contract. Whenever you will stretch the muscle, after removing the stretch force, it will contract. So after applying a stretch reflex over muscle, when one muscle group is going to be contracted, the group 1 afferent, means sensor, which are present in that group of muscle, they will send information to the spinal cord. And you can see in the diagram, the afferent, group 1 afferent from that muscle, the sensor from that muscle is going to the spinal cord. And you can see in the diagram, in the spinal cord, these afferent are making two synapses with both group of muscle. One synapse with the agonist muscle and one synapse with the antagonist muscle of the same joint. Clear? So whenever these impulses are going through group 1 afferent to the spinal cord level, that sensor, that group 1 afferent is making excitatory connection. As you can see in the triangle, white triangle is making excitatory connection. White triangle is making excitatory connection with agonist muscle. At the same time, it is making inhibitory connection with the antagonist muscle of the same joint. So your impulses are going via muscle to the muscle at the spinal cord level, and the same if sensory nerve is making two connections with both group of muscle. We have one connection with agonist muscle and other connection with antagonist muscle. So when signals are going, and what are those connection? It is making excitatory connection. As you can see in the diagram, it is clear, visible. The afferent is making excitatory connection. So whenever it will excite the motor neuron, the excitement of motor neuron will bring signal to the muscle, neuromuscular level at the neuromuscular junction, and it will cause contraction of antagonist muscle because of making excitatory connection of afferent nerve through the efferent nerve of agonist muscle. It will cause contraction of agonist muscle. At the same time, you can see in the diagram, the same afferent is making inhibitory interneuron. You can see the inhibitory interneuron is given by a black triangle. Black triangle means I am trying to display the inhibition by black and excitation by white. So the same afferent interneuron is making inhibitory connection with the alpha motor neuron of antagonist muscle. So at the same time, it can inhibit the excitation of antagonist muscle. So during any smooth and coordinated movement, because of this type of reciprocal innervation pattern of sensory and motor nerve, alpha motor neuron, group 1 afferent and alpha motor neuron, this type of arrangement is possible. When you are going to excite one group of muscle, the sensor will make excitatory synapse with agonist, as well as it will make inhibitory synapse with antagonist. So it will cause excitation of one group of muscle, that is agonist, and at the same time it will cause inhibition of other group of muscle, so that muscle will be relaxed and we will be able to perform a smooth movement. I can demonstrate to you, whenever I am going to produce contraction of one muscle, it means the spinal cord is inhibiting, spinal cord which is controlling the mobility of both muscle, biceps and triceps. When I am going to contract my biceps, it means at the same time the interneuron which are making synapse with triceps muscle motor neuron, it can inhibit the activity of triceps, so triceps get relaxed in that particular movement. We have discussed reciprocal innervation. What is reciprocal innervation? This type of innervation management, this type of innervation mechanism, sensors are going in spinal cord, group 1 afferent is going in spinal cord, making excitatory connection with agonist and making inhibitory connection with antagonist. This type of arrangement in a spinal cord is known as reciprocal innervation. And when this reciprocal innervation work to excite one muscle fiber and inhibit other muscle fiber is known as reciprocal inhibition. And because we are discussing about the neurophysiological response of stress reflex, whenever you will apply stretch over any muscle, it will cause one more inhibition is known as autogenic inhibition. What is autogenic inhibition? Before discussing the autogenic inhibition, we should briefly revise the function, anatomy and function of GTOs, Golgi tendon organs. The main function of Golgi tendon organs is stop the lengthening of muscle, check the lengthening of muscle and produce contraction. Whenever, what is the main function of GTOs? It monitor the tension of muscle fiber being stretched. Whenever you are going to stretch any muscle, the GTOs are present parallel to the muscle fiber and it will cause excitation of GTOs, and GTOs are sending their nerve fiber to the spinal cord and a spinal cord is making synapse with the muscle of that limb. So whenever GTO is excited, it will cause contraction of muscle and this is known as autogenic inhibition. So the GTO, as it monitors tension in the muscle fiber being stressed, has an inhibitory impact on the level of muscle tension in the muscle tendon unit in which it lies. Particularly, if stretch force is prolonged, this effect is called autogenic inhibition. It means whenever you will apply any stretch over any muscle for long time, and whenever you are applying a stretch will cause activation of GTO. So whenever your GTO will activate, it will cause relaxation, it will cause shortening of muscle, is known as autogenic inhibition. And you can see in the diagram, spinal cord is making different connection with muscle fiber as well as GTO. Whenever GTO will excite, it will send information to the spinal cord, and spinal cord, by inhibiting the interneuron, motor interneuron supplying that muscle, it will stop the activity of that muscle. This type of phenomenon is known as autogenic inhibition. Important structure known as neuromuscular junction, okay? Because without nerve, muscle cannot work at all. So by knowing only the anatomy of muscle, we cannot understand the function of muscle, because for functioning of muscle, we need some stimulus from nerve. So how nerve and muscle work in coordination? How nerve get signal, how nerve bring signal, and how muscle respond against that signal. So there is some connection between nerve and muscle which can transfer the message coming from motor nerve, should go in the muscle, and muscle respond according to that signal which was brought by your nerve. So there, at the end of nerve, muscle is going to receive the signal which is coming from nerve, and where nerve and muscle is going to meet is known as neuromuscular junction. So we will discuss the anatomy of neuromuscular junction. What is the neuromuscular junction? Site where motor neuron meets the muscle fiber. What is neuromuscular junction? Site where motor neuron meets the muscle fiber, separated by gap called neuromuscular cleft. There you can see in the diagram, muscle is not directly attaching the nerve fiber. There is some gap, but nerve and muscle both are having contact without touching themselves, and the space which is in between nerve and muscle is known as neuromuscular cleft.
And there is another structure, motor end plate. Motor end plate pocket formed around motor neuron by sarcolemma. Sarcolemma is a muscle membrane. Sarcolemma is a muscle membrane which is going to receive signal coming from nerve. To where muscle is going to receive signal, it make a pocket like structure to receive the signal from nerve. And that pocket like structure is known as motor end plate. As you can see in the diagram, it is clearly mentioned what is your neuromuscular cleft and what is your motor end plate. There is some important chemical very much required for muscle contraction, because without this chemical known as acetylcholine, it is released from motor neuron. Acetylcholine, because we all know when nerve brings signal, the signal will travel all along the nerve in form of electrical signal. But when the signal, that electrical signal is going to enter in muscle, it, because I have told you neuromuscular junction, muscle is not going to attach with your nerve. So they are going to be made contact, but without touching themselves. It means, and we all know, electrical signal cannot transmit without conduction. For transmitting any electrical signal, there should be contact. But in NM junction, neuromuscular junction, there is no contact. So, but signals are going. Signals are going from nerve to muscle. And but when you see, muscle and nerve are not in connection, not in contact. So electrical signal cannot travel. Electrical signal cannot go, because electrical signal needs some contact to travel. But here there is no contact. So because of presence of that acetylcholine, the electrical signals can be converted into chemical signal, and chemical signal can travel from one end to other end without having any contact. This is the main function of acetylcholine, which is released from motor neuron, causes an end plate position. Potential. I have told you what is the end plate, where your sarcolemma is going to make a pocket to receive the signal brought by your neuron. So when, because of your acetylcholine, it is the acetylcholine which can polarize, which can create a potential. What is potential? Potential is the charge difference. What is potential? Potential is the charge difference. And because of difference in potential, current will flow. If you have 5 ion, I have 5 ion, there will be no flow. But if there is any difference, suppose I have 10, you have 5, then my ion can move towards you. Always higher moves towards lower. When we will discuss about the action potential in muscle and nerve physiology, I will elaborate the things. But here you should only know ki there is a, what is potential? Potential mean differences in charge. Differences in charge. And when you will have both, there's membrane, and membrane has charge outside the membrane, inside the membrane. When outside will be equal to inside, there will be no flow of current. But if there is different, either one side is positive, other side is negative, so always there will be flow, movement, there will be some current generation. So this is potential. So because of presence of acetylcholine over the end of your neuron or nerve, it can cause end plane potential, which can cause depolarization of muscle fiber. Depolarization of muscle fiber. Now I will like to tell you what is depolarization. Normally in resting stage, our muscle or nerve has a potential. Potential mean, I have told you, charge difference. Normally in resting stage, what happen? Our cell membrane, or either from nerve or muscle, they are having more amount of sodium ion outside the membrane and less amount of potassium ion inside the membrane. Both sodium and potassium, both are positive ion. But because one side has more positive, other side has less positive. For example, suppose you have $1 billion and I have $1,000. Both has enough money. Both have enough money. But because you have 1 million and I have 1,000, that's why you are richer than me. Same as here, ki both side of membrane, and inside, outside, both side has positive ion mainly, but inside is less positive, that is 2 plus plus in comparison to 3 Na plus outside. That's why in resting stage, there is a potential known as resting membrane potential. But if you apply any stimulus over nerve, it can change the permeability of membrane. So what happened? Ki more inside, more positive will come inside and less positive will be outside. It means condition is changed. Previously, more positive outside, less positive inside. But if you apply any stimulus, any touch, any damage, it can reverse the condition. Ki more positive inside, less positive outside. This type, this phenomenon is known as depolarization of muscle or nerve. If you apply any stimulus over muscle, it happen in muscle. If you apply any stimulus in nerve, it happen in nerve. This process is known as depolarization. We will discuss the process of depolarization and repolarization. We will discuss the function of muscle. Now we will discuss the anatomy of neuromuscular junction. What the neuromuscular junction have? What is the structure? What are those structure which form your neuromuscular junction? First is, because I have told you, neuromuscular junction is made up of nerve and muscle. So in all neuromuscular junction, there will be one motor neuron fiber and its branches. And its branches, muscle fiber, motor end plate, and myofibrillar of motor fiber, mitochondria, synaptic vesicle, synaptic cleft, folded sarcolemma, and motor end plate. Okay? So these structure form the neuromuscular junction. It means motor cell should have its end as well as its branches. But muscle membrane, which is our sarcolemma, which is going to receive the signal, it should have motor end plate, synaptic cleft, synaptic vesicle, mitochondria, folded sarcolemma, and motor end plate. Okay, thank you.